research and kind of want to avoid too many of these. But first question, how, this is for each person to respond to. Do you read a newspaper each day? And if so, in what format or formats do you read it? Okay, there's the first question, or the first pair of questions. If each of you would just respond briefly in the chat. Do you read a newspaper each day? And if so, in what format or formats do you read it? Okay, Q1, thank you. Is my face not on the monitor? I see my face on the monitor. Okay, so getting back to our question, okay, so yes, reading every day in paper form. People read e-news every day. Okay, so I reflect on this myself quite a bit. I've worked in journalism and public relations, and I still keep my hand in that professionally. I teach in journalism and public relations. I find my, and I have, that this gives me a very, very important reasons to read newspapers consistently every day, not just one, but a variety of papers. I began my career in the late 1980s, actually, and at that point I was already in the habit of reading paper newspapers. My first full-time job was in Washington, D.C., and the place that I worked, I was doing public relations, and we subscribed to 5 daily newspapers, which it was my job to monitor for our organization. And we also subscribed to what in those days was called a clipping service. In the days of paper-only newspapers, companies would companies would offer services where you could give them, you could provide them with some topics that you wanted to keep track of in the news, and they would have, they would cover a range of newspapers across the United States and worldwide, and clip out individual stories, which they would paste on a piece of paper and send to us every week. So I was very much in the habit of reading newspapers. When I was growing up, we had a newspaper every day. I used to read it at breakfast every day. And that habit of reading a paper newspaper has continued through much of my life. However, I found, and particularly coming to Kazakhstan, where I don't have access to easy access or cheap access to a paper version of a newspaper that I can read every day. My Russian isn't good enough for me to read a newspaper easily. I do get newspapers here, and I struggle through them. It's not the same process. So most of my news consumption now happens online. And I find that my news reading behavior online is very different than it is in a paper-based world. When I have good, affordable access to a print newspaper, I always turn first to the print newspaper as part of my daily news reading habit. Last year I was in Toronto with my family, and we had access to the Toronto Star, which was delivered to our apartment building every day, and that was, for me, that was after having lived in Kazakhstan for some years, that was very refreshing, because my news gathering behavior is very different online. When I'm online, I find that I access news mostly through secondary sources, mostly through email lists, social networks, and other kinds of services, and not necessarily going directly to news websites. The exception is when I use RSS feeds. You may be familiar with those, that allow me to read news through my own personal newsreader. But where I find that it's not difficult for me to be in the habit of reading a print newspaper every day and reading through the entire newspaper every day. I find in an online environment, my news reading habits are much more disjointed. I tend not to read an entire paper or even look at the entire content of one paper. I have various mechanisms that I use to pick and choose which news sources I'm looking at. In some ways, I find this is beneficial. I get exposed to things through social media from publications that I may not otherwise be exposed to. I have a much wider range of things. I'm range of material from a range of publications that I'm exposed to, although still not as wide ranging as one might hope. I do find that many of the stories that I receive come from only certain political perspectives, and that's not ideal. But what's missing for me in not having access to good access to a good daily print newspaper is that I don't see the full range of news topics that I normally would see when I read a newspaper. I think a lot of, there's a combination for me in reading a newspaper of being exposed to consistent streams of information. For instance, a newspaper will cover one story over a period of time, and if I'm reading that one newspaper, I have a sense of the developing story through the lens of that particular paper, which is important. The other thing that I find, though, is when I read a newspaper, I open the pages, and as I go through the pages, I'm actually more likely in that environment to come across material, stories on issues that I may not have expected to be interested in, but when I see them in the paper, I turn out to be very interested. I make new discoveries. I learn new things through the newspaper. And my impression of dealing with news online for myself, I don't know about other people very much, but my impression of dealing with news online is that I don't have that same level of discovery in the online environment. Certainly there is discovery, there's finding different kinds of things, but as I think about the range of discoveries that I make online, with online news, they aren't, to me, they aren't as substantial, they aren't as useful over time as the discoveries that I make over time in reading a very good daily newspaper. I'd like you to keep this in mind. I don't ask you to accept that or to accept that my experience is the same as other people's experience. But I would like you please to consider that and keep in mind as we're talking about newspapers and about other media. Think about them not just, and with all these media, we shouldn't think about them just as artifacts, just as historical things of historical interest that we should know how they develop. We should think about them as sources of information that we may use in different ways. Remember, a couple of weeks ago we were talking about theories of mass media, and there's the theory of uses and gratifications. This theory tells us that people have certain needs, and they pick and choose, they use media to fulfill these needs. Excuse me. I'd like you to keep that in mind because in my experience, as I think about this uses and gratifications theory in relation to my news reading behavior, I find that the changing environment in which I really have less access now, much less access now, and not just here in Kazakhstan, but when I'm in North America, in North America, news reading behavior has changed. Far more people are reading online. The sources where we would get daily newspapers are disappearing. There are still newsstands in major cities, but there are far fewer of them. It's harder to get a print newspaper, I find. It's harder to get a print newspaper for me now than it was 20 years ago. It's harder for me to get a variety of print newspapers than it was 20 years ago because there's not as much demand, because people are reading those online. And because my behavior with those papers is different in an online environment, I find for myself, there's something in my experience of news. Certainly there's much that I've gained, but there's something that I've also lost in terms of my behavior with news. And so what this tells me is, with the uses and gratifications theory, the uses and gratifications theory says audiences are very strong, readers are very strong, they make decisions about what they want to do with media, and those decisions have an impact back on media. Certainly that's true. However, for someone like me, living in an environment where there's far less demand for print newspapers now, where I value print newspapers, where my experience of print newspapers is extraordinarily important to me, I don't want to say disappearance, but the reduced presence of print publications in an environment that's gone largely online means that I have to make choices in my news reading behavior that are conditioned by things outside of my control. If I had complete control over my environment, I would still live in an environment where I'm reading much of my news in print. I would love to have the internet, see the internet as a supplement to that print environment. That would be my ideal news reading environment. But it's hard to keep that environment going, I find. And this is one of the limitations about the uses and gratifications theory. We can say from uses and gratifications theory, audiences have control. But that control is conditioned by the environment in which they're operating. And that environment is not always the environment as they would choose it to be. Okay, thank you very much for your patience with that rather long introduction. Okay, let's turn now to our examination of newspapers. You remember last week we were talking about books. Newspapers are a related phenomenon. They rely on very similar, almost identical technologies. The transition from of books from a medium that was produced in a craft environment to a mass medium relies on the same development of print technologies as the phenomenon of turning newspapers into mass media. Prehistory of early newspapers. People who study newspapers look back to the Roman Empire, ancient Rome, and the publication of what were called Acta Diurna in Rome. Now, these were not newspapers in the sense that we understand newspapers fully today, but they were publications that came out periodically that had important pieces of information that we refer to now as news. This was the Acta Diurna were our first examples of something that we could liken to a newspaper. You remember from our talk last week about the Gutenberg Press. The Gutenberg Press was, as with books, the Gutenberg Press was the key technology that enabled the transition from transition to a mass medium, a medium that allowed for publication of many copies of the same newspaper to be distributed to a large, very large mass audience. The very first models of periodical publishing were developed in Germany, and it was in that environment that pamphlets, small publications, a pamphlet, I don't think I have any examples here. A pamphlet is just a small publication that carries some information that somebody feels is important. You may see pamphlets on many topics. I took my children to the doctor last week, and they were looking at pamphlets with information about healthcare, things like that. So these emerge in as tools of political and social discourse. After the Gutenberg Press was developed, people found that it was very useful for promoting social and political ideas to publish pamphlets on those issues. Excuse me, I have something in my throat today, I think. In the early 1800s, in Europe and in North America, there developed what was called a penny press. Penny press is consists of very cheap periodicals, which were aimed at mass market. Now, prior to this time, newspapers were not completely elite, but a relatively expensive item for people. Although they were mass publications, they weren't publications that were aimed at mass audience. They were publications that were aimed at business people, at decision makers, and they didn't attempt to reach people from middle and lower classes. They were relatively expensive for people from those classes to buy. The penny press, and there's a paper, the Chicago Sun, that's an example of this. Penny press represents a shift in business models by newspaper publishers to reach not just the market of business people, of decision makers, but to reach a mass audience. And the formula that was used in terms of economic terms, the formula being used was one that saw that if we're publishing, let's say for the sake of argument, if it costs us $100 to pay our writers to produce a newspaper, and we can sell 200 copies at $1 for each paper, then selling it for $1, we make $100 profit. If we take the same $100 to produce the newspaper, and we can sell the newspaper for 25 cents, and in selling it for 25 cents, we can sell 10,000 copies, we make $24,000 in profit on that one newspaper. That's the formula that went into development of the kind of formula, the kind of thinking that went into developing the penny press. The idea was, if we can sell many more copies, if we can reduce the cost of our product and sell many more copies, we can make a much higher level of profit in our work. As newspapers developed, as communication technologies developed, there developed wire services. The main wire services in the United States were Associated Press, AP, and United Press International, UPI. This was a combination of communication technologies. It was a bringing together of print technology with initially the telegraph, and the telegraph was the key technology. A telegraph was a wired technology. You may remember Clay Shirky referring to the wired technologies, the conversational technologies of telegraph and later on telephone, which allowed voice to be transmitted over wires. People who were selling news, who were marketing news, saw huge advantages in the speed with which information could be transmitted with those conversational technologies. And what they did, and this very much strengthened what newspapers were offering, they were able to place reporters around the world and to use wired technologies, telegraph, to communicate stories to the newspaper itself, which could be published in the home country. This was a very important innovation for early newspapers. Another innovation, this is not a technical innovation, this is a style of innovation with newspapers, was we call yellow journalism. Yellow journalism was a sensational style in newspapers, what we sometimes refer to as a tabloid style for newspapers. And it was a style that relied on sensationalism, on flashy stories. Critics of yellow journalism point out the degree to which newspapers that were associated with this style would actually make up stories, would create stories in order to create sensational stories in order to draw an audience to sell more newspapers. A publisher who was very closely associated with this style of journalism was William Randolph Hearst, and he developed one of the early newspaper empires, the Hearst Empire, made up of many newspapers that were producing this style of journalism that was producing shocking stories and lurid headlines to sell more and more newspapers. Newspapers, books developed as a medium that was a medium in which the audience purchased copies of a publication, and that was the primary way that the way that books were financed. And it's been that way. That's been the dominant model of book publishing basically as long as we've had book publishing industries. There have been attempts with book publishing industries to insert advertising in books, to use books to help fund books with by selling advertising. At least in North America, those models have all failed. I remember when I was young, I used to read a lot of paperback books growing up, and I remember an attempt at a certain time to start inserting ads in the center of paperback books so that people would see the ads while they were reading the book. And this didn't last very long. Readers didn't like that at all. They responded very badly to it. That's not the case with newspapers. Newspapers developed as an advertising-based medium. And this is, in some ways, this is related to the massification of publication. People who publish newspapers often early on in the newspaper in newspaper industries, publishers found that advertising was not just something that they could sell through newspapers, but that advertisers wanted. Excuse me, please. But it was actually something that readers wanted. Many readers of newspapers were interested not just in the stories, and sometimes not even primarily in stories that were carried in newspapers, but were interested in advertisements. Advertisements became a form of news. Somebody may want to know about sales happening at a particular store, about services that are available that they might be interested in. Newspapers developed as a medium that carried inexpensive current advertising. And there was quite a bit of demand. Excuse me, quite a bit of demand both from advertisers and from readers for newspapers to carry advertisements. This contributed to the expansion of newspapers as a mass medium, because newspaper publishers could rely not just on the cost of a subscription or on the cost of a copy of a newspaper which someone might buy at a newsstand to fund the newspaper. They could rely even more so on the money that they received from advertising to fund the newspaper. And in fact, the dominant financial model in newspaper publishing has been to rely for most of a newspaper's income, to rely on advertising as the primary source of income, and subscriptions and so on as only a secondary source of income. One of the main problems facing newspapers, the news industry at this time, is that the internet has become a much better source of advertising for various forms of advertising than newspapers were. Newspapers used to rely very much on what were called classified advertisements. Small individual ads that somebody might buy. Let's say you have a bicycle you're selling, or you want to rent an apartment out. You may take an individual ad with a newspaper, a very small ad that advertises whatever it is that you're marketing. Newspapers used to get a huge portion of their income from, particularly from that kind of advertising. With the advent of the internet, that kind of advertising moved to websites like Craigslist is a big example of a website that specializes in what we call classified advertising. That kind of advertising has moved away from newspapers and off to specialized publications on the internet. And it's left newspapers without a tremendous gap in their income. So that's an example of one of the problems now facing newspapers on the internet. In any case, so the difference, a key difference between books and newspapers, books developed as a medium where income came almost exclusively from sales of the book itself to the public, whereas newspapers developed as an advertising-driven medium, where most of the income for the newspaper came from sales of advertising in the newspaper and not sales of the paper itself. Okay, these are the questions that I was asking at the beginning of our session, so we'll skip by those. Okay, a couple of issues about storytelling in newspapers. Those of you who know about journalism probably have heard we talk in journalism schools and in journalism businesses, we talk a lot about the idea of objectivity, about the presentation of facts. As newspapers developed, as media that people relied on for information about that they needed to know in order to live their lives, in order to deal effectively with the world around them, they really came to rely on newspapers to be sources of reliable information. Now, the very earliest newspapers they didn't keep this entirely an objective perspective. Early newspapers often came from a particular political or ideological perspective. They were often published by political parties, by people with a strong political perspective, and they would embrace that perspective in reporting their news. Much of early news reading behavior recognizes this. If you wanted to know in the 1700s or 1800s and even beyond, if you wanted to know what was going on in the world around you, it was often most useful to choose a selection of papers from a variety of perspectives to avoid getting just one perspective. As newspapers developed as an industry in and of itself, separate from particular ideological perspectives, newspaper publishers found that it was important for them to be seen as trusted sources of information. So newspapers developed a style in which, and some more than others, but developed a style in which they tried to be objective about the information that they presented. They tried to present information in a way that suggested that the person telling us a story was trying to remain as free as possible of bias, was trying to present as clearly and even-handedly as possible to us the news. This approach developed in large part as a response to yellow journalism, as a response to this tendency of some newspapers to promote hysteria, to move away from, to stay away from objective view in order to sell lots of copies. The objective perspective in journalism developed as a response to this, and as a way to promote the idea that newspapers could be trusted sources of information. There's another style issue. In news reporting, they developed something called the inverted pyramid style. The inverted pyramid of style of writing in journalism is one where the very most important piece of information in a story goes at the top, the headline, and then the next important goes next, and the next important following that. It's a ranking of what's most important, what's newest and most important in any particular story. This style developed simultaneously as an attempt to make the news story most useful to busy people. If news was written in a way that the very most important information went at the top of the story, then people could just scan the story and read as far down as they felt they needed to until they started seeing things they already knew in the story. That's part of how the inverted pyramid style developed. It was something that helped editors also. If reporters were trained to write in the inverted pyramid style, particularly important for reporters who were delivering their stories through wire services, which were relatively expensive to use. An editor could rely on the reporter to present information with the most important information at the top of the story, and the editor could very easily edit the story for length, cutting it off at any point. The length of a story is a very important consideration in a newspaper because, it costs money to print a newspaper. Paper costs, there's a limited amount of space in a paper, so this inverted pyramid style made it very easy to shorten stories. Simply, if you don't have enough space in a paper for a full story, you just rip off the bottom and the rest of the story goes in very easily. So there are other styles of newspaper reporting that developed, literary, interpretive, advocacy. I won't go into a lot of detail about those except to say that those styles often can be used in conjunction with other styles by some newspapers. So for example, a newspaper may have a special edition where they have a section that contains stories that are written in a more a longer style. these are oftentimes still used to draw audiences. there are also developed what we call niche newspapers, newspapers that serve particular kinds of communities, underground newspapers that would serve communities of people who felt somehow separate from mainstream society, neighborhood newspapers, ethnic newspapers, and so on. So all these styles can be seen developing in the newspaper industries. There's a term that we use in communication studies, particularly people who study journalism, called gatekeeping. Clay Shirky used this term in his video on the new communication ecosystem. When we talk about gatekeeping in communication studies, we're usually referring to an era in which people gathered much of their information about what was going on in the world from relatively few news sources. When I was growing up, I grew up in Boston. When I was growing up in Boston, we had maybe a dozen or more radio stations that I could reach, that I received at home. I grew up outside of Boston, actually. There were two papers published in Boston, which were the dominant newspapers in the town I grew up in. And there was one town newspaper that was published once a week. So two daily newspapers published in Boston and one weekly newspaper published in the town itself. There were four, this was in the broadcast era, we had, there was UHF and VHF channels. There were three VHF channels, no, I'm sorry, four VHF channels that I could receive at home, and half a dozen UHF channels, so ten television channels, more or less. I go through all this to give you an idea of there was a range of mass media available when I was growing up, but much less than is easily available today through the internet. In that era when I grew up, the idea of gatekeeping was very important for understanding how people got information from mass media and what the limitations on them were, what limitations they had to deal with in understanding information. Right? Let's bring it down to one particular newspaper now. A newspaper may employ a certain number of people as reporters and editors. There's a certain amount of space in the newspaper. And the people who are responsible for putting the paper together have to make certain decisions. They make decisions about what's important to cover, what's newsworthy. where do we find our news? Do we find our news by going to government offices, by keeping track of what's happening in with police organizations, hospitals? Do we go to neighborhoods and talk to community groups? Reporters and editors have to make decisions about what constitutes news, about who is a reliable, who is a newsworthy person, who is an authority that we talk to in trying to understand the news, so on and so forth. In making, now those are some, those are, that's a certain kind of decision. Then another kind of decision about the news is how much news can we fit into our newspaper? In other words, if we're marketing a newspaper that carries a certain amount of advertising, how much actual news, which we have to pay for, we have to pay the reporters. Nobody pays to create the news. We have to pay the reporters to cover stories, write stories, put them in the paper. We have to pay editors to edit the stories. We have to pay various people to illustrate and to do layout and all these sorts of things. There are formulas that news organizations use to determine this. So the amount of information, the amount of news that goes into a newspaper is also a limitation. If I'm running a newspaper as a business, I have to make decisions related to those two areas in putting the newspaper together. In making those decisions, I have to necessarily say, these things can be in the newspaper, these things can't be in the newspaper. Those decisions affect a large number of people. Those decisions affect our readers. When a news editor, when people working in a news organization make decisions related to what goes in and what does not go into the publication or the broadcast or whatever it is that they're producing, those decisions have an impact later on the people who rely on that publication or broadcast as a news source. This is where the idea of gatekeeping comes in. Okay, the word gatekeeper, let's see if I can get my hands up into the screen. There. Imagine a gate. You're walking in a field and you come up to a fence and there's a gate. It can open, it can close. Open and close, right? A gatekeeper is a person who makes decisions about when to open the gate and let things through, and when to close the gate and not let things through. When we talk about the gatekeeping function, this is with respect to actually to any mass media, can also be with respect to organizations that have an impact on making news available, like governments making decisions about what information they release and don't release. But we're talking about it now particularly with respect to newspapers. The gatekeeping function is a function where, and we say that this has a big impact on audiences, where the people who put together the newspaper make decisions. What will we report on? Who will we cover? What institutions will we cover? What areas? What topics? When we choose to cover certain things, we're opening the gates to those things. When we choose not to cover, closing gates. Okay? The idea of gatekeeping is the idea that this process has a big impact on the audience, a big impact on the people who are reading newspapers. this has changed quite a bit in the internet era. Now, I was listing for you, when I was growing up, the number of news sources that that were prominent in the town that I was growing up in. Now, it's not a tiny amount. I was living in a near a major U.S. city, and I had much better access to news sources, for example, than cousins of mine who were growing up in rural Maine, or other people that I know living in other parts of the country. So the example that I gave was, in the time that I was growing up, I was living in what might be called a relatively media-saturated environment. I had lots of choice compared to many other people, but still, there were limitations on the choices that I had. Compare that to now on the internet. On the internet, I have access to many, many more information sources. Professional news sources like newspapers, magazines, broadcast stations, but also amateurs and just plain people. There's a lot more opportunity for ideas to get into the news through channels other than traditional mass media. And this is important for understanding the process of gatekeeping. The gatekeeping function in an internet environment, the gatekeeping function for professional news organizations changes somewhat. Professional news organizations no longer are the only sources we can turn to for news. They're no longer the only sources available in a mass environment for news. They are still dominant in many ways. They are still dominant voices because they produce professional news, because they produce it in particular ways. They're considered reliable sources, so on and so forth. But other kinds of sources of information get more exposure now in an internet environment than they ever could have before, and they're changing the idea of gatekeeping, the gatekeeping function for newspapers. Another function of newspapers. We talk in communication fields, in the study of journalism, we talk about newspapers as watchdogs. I'm sure you're all familiar with what a watchdog is. It's a dog, usually a trained dog, that somebody may have on their property. And they use the dog to help secure their property. If you come to the property and you're not known to the dog may bark, may make a lot of noise, or it may just intimidate you from entering into the property without proper permission. Right? When newspapers take on the role of informing people about what's going on in society, about informing them about what government is doing, what businesses are doing, how is it going to affect you. In doing this in a way, not just to give the perspective of government or businesses to people, but to watch what government and businesses are doing, and to let people know. We talk about this in journalism studies as newspapers taking on a watchdog role. They're taking on a role of providing us information that allows us to keep track of what important institutions are doing. Of course, our textbook has a U.S. focus. It provides this information to you from a U.S. perspective. You can see similar lists of dominant papers for many different countries. In the U.S., the dominant newspaper is USA Today. It's a relatively recent publication. It started in the 1980s and very quickly became popular as a nationwide publication producing short, easy to digest stories. It was referred to in an insulting way, I remember, as McPaper, to suggest that it's like a fast food restaurant for newspapers. Other prominent newspapers with perhaps lower circulation than USA Today, but still very prominent high circulation publications are the Wall Street Journal, New York Times, Los Angeles Times, Washington Post, Chicago Tribune, and so on. Most newspapers in the United States are identified with a particular city. This is an extension of a sense of localization, of focus on a particular area. Many newspapers are published by publishing chains, so they may have newspapers in many different cities. And the focus in each newspaper will focus on a particular city, and that trend still exists today. Readership trends. Television and the internet have drawn many readers away from newspapers, and particularly from physical newspapers. Right now, newspapers are facing competition from the internet, and they've had to turn to the internet and to change what they're doing. And newspaper businesses are still wrestling with how to survive in the online environment. The business model for newspapers, one where readers would either subscribe to newspapers or buy them on a newsstand, and advertisers would pay for advertising that was delivered through the newspaper to these people. This model isn't working so well for newspapers these days. There's lots of competition for newspapers. And that competition is drawing away, as I talked about classified ads, it's drawing away very important sources of revenue for newspapers. Also, it seems like readers are not generally inclined to pay for subscriptions online. They will for some publications, for some very prominent publications, New York Times and a few other prominent publications. They've been able to sell some subscriptions. Many newspapers now boast about having lots of subscribers, but the truth of the matter is that many of the online subscriptions that newspapers say they have are actually just extensions of their print service. In other words, if somebody subscribes to the newspaper, to a print version of the newspaper, which still some people like myself do, then the newspaper may give them or sell them at a very small additional cost, the online subscription. Many of the online subscriptions to newspapers are sold that way rather than as standalone subscriptions. So readers seem not to be inclined to pay for a subscription online. Physical copies. Now, this happened in Toronto, where I told you last year I was reading the Toronto Star in my apartment building. That's not the whole story, actually, because I was reading, and I would have paid for a subscription to the Toronto Star, except in cities they're finding it's not always economically feasible to deliver subscriptions, paid subscriptions, to people in the city. Paid subscriptions require keeping track of who's subscribing, going to, you know, delivering the paper, collecting money, sending somebody to deliver the paper to a specific person. This is a costly mechanism for delivering a newspaper. And with lower and lower numbers of subscribers, the possibility for hand delivering a newspaper is reduced. It becomes more expensive to do that. The building that I was living in Toronto, the Toronto Star, used to come every morning to our building. There were a few hundred apartments. A few hundred apartments in the building that I lived in. And every morning a van would come. A man would get out with a stack of newspapers. Stack of newspapers would be usually 50 newspapers Monday through Friday, and maybe 25 newspapers on Saturday, which Saturday is the day in Canada where the big edition of the newspaper is published. And they would just come and leave them in the lobby. Nobody had to pay for them. It was a free service. And anybody who wanted to could go downstairs and take a newspaper and bring it up to their apartment. And I went down every day. I picked up a newspaper and brought it back up. I was very happy to have that service. The reason this worked for the Star, the Toronto Star was having problems with circulation. When you rely on advertising to sell a newspaper, what you're relying on is advertisers knowing that when they pay for the advertisement in the newspaper, people will see the advertisements, that there are readers out there. So it's a double crisis for newspapers when the number of subscribers goes down. It's a double crisis because as the number of subscribers go down, not only do you sell fewer copies, you have less income from selling copies of the paper, but even more importantly, advertisers are not willing to pay so much for ads when they know they aren't getting in front of as many people. So many newspapers are doing things to give away newspapers in order to keep circulation numbers up, in order to keep advertising dollars coming in, to convince advertisers that it's worth it for them to spend money on advertising. So the Toronto Star was giving away newspapers in the city by leaving them in apartment lobbies. They would leave them every day at public libraries throughout the city. They would leave stacks of newspapers every day in the public libraries for people just to pick up and read. And they would send people out on the street to give away copies of the newspaper. This worked very well for me because I didn't have to pay for the I would have paid for the newspaper, I didn't have to, so I got it for free. It apparently it works for the Star. They are keeping their circulation numbers up higher than they would otherwise by through this campaign of giving away newspapers. But it's a concern for people who value newspapers. It's actually a big concern. Everybody likes getting things for free. I liked getting the Star for free. But I'll tell you, if I knew that it would help maintain a quality publication like the Star, to pay for that publication, if I knew that my paying for it and many other people paying for it at the same time would keep the Star running, I would prefer to do that. Problem for me as an individual, and this is something that many people face in many situations, problem for me as an individual is my individual money is not going to do anything for the Star. That's the situation that we're in right now with newspapers. Readership numbers are down, advertising dollars are down, and newspapers are wrestling with how do we charge for our product in a way that ensures we keep readership up? How do we convince advertisers that we're the primary medium, we're the best medium for them to advertise, so on and so forth? So there are different responses to this. One response, the Philadelphia Inquirer, a prominent mid-sized newspaper in the United States, very high quality newspaper, the Philadelphia Inquirer in the recent years restructured itself as a nonprofit organization. And that's a different kind of approach that some newspapers are taking. So some of the responses to trends in readership, lower numbers of readers of newspapers, one response has been something we call joint operating agreements, where two newspapers, usually competing newspapers, two newspapers in the same area will share facilities and resources. They'll share a printing press. They'll share sometimes office space. They may share subscription services, the people that run their advertising, that kind of thing. This has some advantages. It allows newspapers to reduce costs by sharing some of the costs between papers. And to continue, it helps to promote continued diversity of news in a city. Now this is something that happens particularly in mid-sized cities. If we think that a variety of voices is important, and this is one of the fundamental ideas of democracy, is the idea that a variety of voices in society are important. If we want to maintain a variety of voices, having joint operating agreements is one way that people see, one kind of a compromise that communities can make to allow two newspapers, perhaps more, to coexist side by side by cutting production costs. Something that a lot of people don't like joint operating agreements because they turn competitors into allies, and that may itself reduce the diversity of voices in the news industry. But faced with the possibility of having a single newspaper in a city, or no newspaper in a city, many cities have decided it's better to allow joint operating agreements to go forward rather than to lose diversity. There are many cities in the United States, mid-sized cities, that have become single newspaper cities. This is not ideal. It's good to have competing voices, to have a diversity of voices in society, and having those voices in news is very important. Voices on the internet have often stepped in to fill some of this gap. I lived in Tucson, Arizona for some years, and I worked for part of that time, I worked at a weekly newspaper in Arizona, in Tucson, Arizona. When I was there, Tucson had two newspapers, two daily newspapers, and one weekly newspaper. Since then, since I left Tucson in the late 1990s, since I left, one of the newspapers failed. I believe there's only one daily newspaper, print newspaper in Tucson now. And that newspaper purchased the weekly newspaper where I had worked. So even though it's a separate newspaper, it's owned by the same company that runs the daily paper, which suggests reducing diversity in the news field. However, online there are a few businesses running that are promoting daily news. There's an online project called the Tucson Sentinel, which is an online-only newspaper. It's run by the son of a prominent Tucson journalist who was a columnist for the weekly newspaper that I work for. And it's run as a nonprofit organization, and they're involved very heavily in promoting local online news organizations nationwide in the United States. So that's something that people are doing online to try to promote diversity in news and try to ensure and try to take advantage of the internet as a different platform through which to deliver news and through which to develop a news organization. So that's another trend that's happening. Newspaper chains, of course, newspaper chains have been prominent for generations in the United States. Usually the way they operate is that chains will own newspapers in many different cities. Each city has reporters producing news. Most of the news, or much of the news in a particular paper will come from the bureau in that city. But bureaus from each city will share their news with all the other newspapers in the chain, and all those newspapers will publish material from different papers. So this is another way that newspapers can reduce their costs and thrive economically. Readership trends. We've already discussed competition from online sources. There are many sources of news now, and they're competing for attention from an audience that used to turn largely to newspapers. Online newspapers can be daily, they can be weekly, can't be daily or weekly only. They're now 24/7, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week propositions. Not only that, but newspapers now in competing with a variety of news organizations, newspapers can't rely just on text and photos to deliver their messages as they used to. Now newspapers are producing video. The New York Times has a very prominent section of its website, which is where they do nothing but produce video. They produce video, they produce audio, they provide links to further sources of information. Many newspapers are becoming convening sites for community discussions and other sorts of things. So newspapers are trying to diversify what they do in order to provide to better provide news services to communities and to be the sources that people go to for information. They're trying very hard to discover new models of operating that will help them keep their audiences. Okay, our final question that I'd like you to leave you with. Drawing back to Shirky, the discussion question, what is it about the 20th century newspaper? And when I say 20th century newspaper, I mean the newspaper that was produced in the era that Shirky talks about, in which media are all separate. Broadcast is broadcast, and in fact, television is one thing, radio is another. Newspapers, another, books, magazines, all separate. An environment in which people have to rely on a relatively low number of sources for information. What is it about the 20th century newspaper model that might make newspapers good at making groups? And how might that ability to be good at making groups change for newspapers in the online environment? That's the question I'd like to leave you with. I'd like you to think about that and perhaps post something to our Facebook group. Why is it that the 20th century newspaper that makes it good at making groups? And how might that ability to be good at making groups change for newspapers in the online environment? Okay, thank you very much. My voice is going to give out, and that's all I have for today. I will be back next week with the next chapter. I believe Ken will come back to you in 10 minutes, so I think we'll take probably a 10-minute break here. Maybe Ken can confirm that for us. Okay, thank you all very much for your attention. Thank you for your participation on the questions I was asking. 10-minute break now, and then Ken will be back to continue the discussion until the end of today's class. So have a good week, and I will see you next week. Thank you very much.
Okay. First off, addressing Professor Kim's question, I will send you the revised syllabus in just a few minutes. It's already done. I just didn't send it to you yet. Can you hear me okay first? I'm trying to speak down to my microphone. I don't have a headset, or I prefer not to use a headset when I don't have to. Okay. Excuse me. The syllabus, as far as the presentations goes, has not changed. So next week, I don't remember right now who selected chapter 5, but next week will be chapter 5, yes. So that has not changed. So I will send you the syllabus. I actually did not change, I think I changed one date, one presentation date, I think probably chapter 14, because nobody chose chapter 13. So and there were two the next week, 14 and 15. So I think I moved chapter 14 up in place of chapter 13. I will send it to you as soon as our class is over. So yes, that's an important question, obviously. So other than that, the syllabus you have now, the dates are okay, except I believe it's chapter 14 moved one week sooner. So I'll send that to you. There were also, please note in the new syllabus, there's changes in the grading system since you're doing two presentations instead of one. I went back to the way that we graded previously, so I could take some points away from your online participation. Not all of them, but some of the points from your Facebook online participation, and I think one other thing. But anyway, it went back to the way it was last year, or the way it was when we first started the semester, when I thought we were going to have, I guess maybe not the start of the semester, but anyway, the way it was last year. So you'll double check how the points will be rewarded or awarded. Everything is, the only difference is that some of the points move from other areas into your second presentation. Okay, I wanted to follow up on some of the things that Frederick was teaching. I do have a somewhat different perspective in some things, just because our backgrounds are different. As I've explained in the past, I've been a newspaper publisher, so I've been more involved with the business side than he has. I'm, of course, also been a journalist and an editor and so forth. So I've seen it. I've worked at weekly news, large circulation, metropolitan weekly newspapers that were totally free of charge, no subscription cost whatsoever. I've worked for a daily newspaper owned by the largest newspaper chain in America now, McClatchy, as an editor. And that was supported by both subscription and by advertising. I've owned small weekly newspapers where I was the only person, just about the only person on staff, just maybe two other halftime people, I guess. So I've seen the whole gamut. So you may get a little bit different perspective from, and also I did some recent, I mentioned I think before, I just recently co-authored a book on the impact of mobile technologies on lots of different things. One of them was on journalism and on news media. So I have some information from that recent research that updates what we've been talking about also. So let me just go through some of this and kind of reflect on some of the changes that we already talked previously about the organization of a newspaper. This would be, as I mentioned, more of a mid-sized daily. There might be some differences. Actually, at this level, this is probably fairly universal for daily newspapers, except possibly the executive editor and managing editor might be the same person. The ad manager and the classified manager might be the same person. The HR director might be the publisher. He may do it himself. So it depends on how big your organization is. Smaller newspapers over the last, 30 years or so have not had their own presses. typically, so they've jobbed theirs out. Even some of the bigger newspapers no longer have run their own presses. That press is what you print the newspaper with. And of course, IT director in a smaller newspaper, somebody else would take that responsibility probably. So certainly it's quite typical, I put it that way. Now, there's going to be differences in every newspaper. Like I said, I'm going to close some of these parts so you don't have to see them. Okay. We also talked about previously about some of the newspaper organization, and I just mainly wanted to refer to this again. One of my jobs at the Daily Newspaper was as the wire editor. Frederick talked about gatekeeping. A couple of aspects of gatekeeping that are worth mentioning, I think. One is that kind of on the positive side. Every day in most daily newspapers, there is what they call a front page meeting. And so in our newspaper, again, around 50,000 circulation, the executive editor, the managing editor, the metro editor, the wire editor, and sometimes other people would be invited in as well. The photo editor would usually come in. The sports editor would come in if he really thought he had something so important that it should go on the front page. That didn't happen very often, so he didn't bother to come in very often. But anyway, those people at least, the photo editor may or may not come in. He may send his photos in with somebody else and go back to work again, but he would somehow contribute to the discussion of what could be on the front page with photos that he either had in hand or expected to get in. We would gather together at around 5 o'clock in the afternoon for a morning newspaper, and we would go over all the stories we knew about. And so I would bring all the most important stories that were coming in or that I knew were going to come in, related to national news and international news. The metro editor would come in with the regional wire news, covering our state and the Northwest, the part of America. And he would also come in with the list of stories that were written by our own reporters. And if the feature editor had something she thought should come in, she might come in, but not usually. Same with sports, as I mentioned. And the photo editor would show us what photos he had and discuss what photos were still coming. And there'd be a discussion on then what should go on the front page. And so they might choose two of my top stories that I was recommending, maybe three local stories, and then one other story might be different days. When I say local stories, maybe one would be a state story, and maybe they had two local stories. So we tried to have six stories on the front page of a large size, what we call broadsheet newspaper. And so we argued over what should be there. Ultimately, the executive editor would make the decision. So he made the decision, but he made it an informed decision based on our arguments. There were some times when I kind of got upset with this process, however. I remember there was a story that came in about a family that was claiming that they had gotten sick by some pesticide spray that had drifted down to their house from an airplane that had done aerial spraying of an orchard. I believe it was 2 miles away. At the time, my brother is now deceased. My brother was one of the top agronomists in the world, and he'd done a lot of research on pesticides. And I was just curious. I asked him, what do you think about this? Is this feasible? That multiple members of a family would all get sick from this pesticide that was drifting in the air from 2 miles away? And he just laughed at it. He said, no, there's no way. There's no way. First off, he said, probably if they were a lot closer than that even, there are multiple factors, he said, is that, first off, the pesticides are already, when they're tested on mice, and they will test a mouse, to give, expose a mouse to like 100 times the concentration that is used in the on the farm to see if the mouse will get cancer or whatever. And so the testing is quite thorough that, you know, they're pretty safe relatively anyway. But once they get diluted and then they start drifting, the odds that anybody would get sick from them, he said, were pretty low. And that multiple members of the same family, well, even less. In fact, he said it was impossible. That was his conclusion. Now, I don't know if it's impossible or not impossible. But my what happened in that meeting was that I said, look at, we need to talk to an expert in this and get their perspective on it. Because so far, this story is only from the perspective of these people and special interest group that are, you know, environmentally, very environmentally involved. I'm sorry, yes, I will try to slow down. So you're talking about environmental special interest group and a family, you know, claiming, you know, that may have just kind of, you know, they get, it's kind of like here in Kazakhstan. I don't know how it is in Korea, but people here are terrified by anything cold. It can be, there's some people here that are, they're afraid of wind per se. And so they won't open a window even in the summer because they're afraid they'll catch a summer cold. Of course, colds are caused by viruses. They're not caused by wind, and they're not even caused by cold. Now, if you stay outside for a long time and you're very, very cold, you haven't drained, you know, there, yes, you might, you know, the viruses that are, that you're already exposed to might then have a better chance to grow in your body because your body's busy spending its energy on warming you up and not on fighting germs. But a lot of people here won't drink a cold drink because they swear up and down that a cold drink will give them a cold. Well, again, extremely, can it contribute? Maybe in a ultra minor way. But nonetheless, the people here are convinced that it does. So when they catch a cold, they think back and say, aha, I drank a cold drink the other day. Or aha, I had a window open and it was cold. Aha, that's why I caught this cold. Well, they don't even think about the fact that they drove on a bus that was overcrowded. People were standing side by side, coughing at each other. You know, germs are flying all over the place. They don't blame that. They blame the fact they drank a cold Coca-Cola or whatever. So my point is that some people, when they expect something, they can find, or, you know, they find a problem, they look for the cause of that problem, and that cause may not be the real cause. The executive editor, that, you know, this group of all the top people in this newsroom, totally ignored me, and so we ran probably three or four stories on this family, put them on the front page, and they never assigned a reporter or asked the reporter to go talk to an expert like my brother, who would have a scientific perspective on it. So gatekeeping, there's pros and cons. You know, there's good things about gatekeeping, like this front page meeting where we get to discuss it and argue it. The bad thing is there are prejudices within newsrooms that cause gatekeeping to keep out certain perspectives, invite in other perspectives. A newspaper will run certain stories. They won't run other stories. When they run a story, they might lead with one perspective, and the other perspective, if they carry it at all, might be from a lower source. I think I started talking in a previous presentation how a study of the top 20 news sources showed that 18 of them used significantly more liberal sources than conservative sources. Well, if you have more liberal sources, then probably their perspective is going to be carried more strongly than the conservative source. Gatekeeping is involved in this newspaper organization. I know one editor, he was in a much bigger newspaper, the Washington, D.C. Regional editor, I guess his title was, I can't remember exactly what his title, of the New York Times, said that that he had to be very careful and try, and almost have to push his reporters into doing some stories they didn't really want to do because of their political orientation. And so he had to kind of push them and make them do them. And so a good editor may have to do that. Okay, going on to other subjects, however. I wanted to share some ideas from lessons that I've, from different newspapers that I've published that relate to things that, that Frederick mentioned. Partly about circulation, there's a very tight correlation between circulation and advertising. He mentioned the Toronto Star and how they've started giving away their newspaper. Well, that's actually for decades now, many newspapers have been given away because most money comes from advertising, most net revenue. And I say net because circulation revenue might be quite high, but the cost of circulation is also quite high. And so the rule of thumb in most newspapers is that subscriptions will pay for circulation. You can't expect much of a profit from circulation in this day and age, if any. And so, but the circulation, the total circulation is vital to how much advertising you will sell. And so you have to keep your circulation up in order to sell advertising, which is your main source. And meanwhile, like the Toronto Star, they reduced their cost of distributing because they started leaving newspapers at apartment buildings, stuff like that. And they kept their circulation up to where they could sell their advertising for a higher price per what we call per column inch. Well, one of the first lessons I learned as a newspaper man was my first job when I left the university. I had joined the staff of a large weekly metro newspaper in Tampa, Florida. I started as a reporter and then became editor. I was actually hired as the editor, but I guess the owner knew he was going to get rid of the current editor and wanted me to be in place to take his spot. So I started as a reporter and then within a few months became the editor. But before I even got there, they had, this was a brand new newspaper. It was a free circulation newspaper. The idea was to have over 100,000 circulation. There were two daily newspapers. One had about 70,000 paid circulation. One had about 30,000 paid circulation. And like I said, ours was, we were aiming at over 100,000 circulation. But when they first started, the president, who was rather unethical, in order to sell advertising, he told people we already had 75,000 circulation right from the start. Well, that was, you know, like I said, it was before I got there, but we didn't have anywhere. Well, two things. First off, just because you give somebody a free newspaper doesn't mean they're going to read it. So there's a problem even if you put out those newspapers and they are successfully taken to the front step of somebody's house or picked up from a newsstand, will they actually read it? Well, that relates to reading habits. You know, what kind of habit? Frederick was kind of talking about his own reading habits. And everybody has a reading habit, especially when it comes to the news. What do we do? How do we read? What do we read? And so even if you get a free newspaper and you've never heard of this newspaper before and they deliver it to your front door, will you actually read it? Well, actually, I don't think most people at first did. Meanwhile, so he was saying that we had 75,000 circulation when we really probably had half of that. Now, the lesson I learned from that, if you're going to start your own newspaper, if you're going to lie about it, lie the other direction. If you're going to, even if you have, if you put out 75,000 circulation, tell them you put out 35,000. Because advertisers aren't idiots. They can feel the impact of a newspaper. Sometimes they have scientific ways to judge it. Other times it's just, you know, like they put a coupon in. How many people brought in a coupon? They put a coupon in the daily paper. they put a coupon in this new newspaper, and if nobody brings in a coupon from the new newspaper, they figure it's not worth anything. So during this period of changing people's habits, you don't want to lie that you've had that you have more circulation than you really do. If you're going to lie, you should lie the other direction, that you have less circulation. Because the truth is, you do have far less readership than you have circulation. So that was one of the first things I learned because that hurt the newspaper for the rest of its existence until they finally sold it. There were some of the advertisers who came in the first week and believed what the president told them, and then realized that they were being cheated, and they quit advertising, and they never, never, ever came back again. So circulation and advertising, very closely related. You need, you know, real readership. You know, circulation just by number doesn't mean nearly as much as readership. That's a little harder to determine, but that's really the bottom line. You're selling readership. When you sell advertising, you're selling readership of ads. That's what you're really selling. You're not selling ad space. You're selling readership of ads. And so if your circulation is totally tied into advertising. I mentioned last week, I think, or some other time, as an editor, I made the newspaper rather controversial. It wasn't yellow journalism, but I took it as far as I could go ethically in my code of ethics in order to make it interesting, which normally meant writing the most interesting stories. I wouldn't choose a story that was just informational, that had no pizzazz to it, that wasn't interesting to people. I had to find stories that I felt strongly they would be interested in. So that was, you know, kind of the basis for what we're doing. But what some of the stories became somewhat controversial among the establishment of the city, the people that kind of ran the city. And my general manager, who was the son of the owner, was a member of a service club with, I think I did mention this, but I just want to reemphasize it, with a couple of men who didn't like what we were putting in our newspaper. They thought it was too controversial. And so he came back to me and said, we're going to change the content of the newspaper to be less controversial. We're going to write stories about schools and social clubs and stuff. And that's, as I told you, I think before, is when I said, I won't do that. You will destroy the newspaper because you will destroy readership. I'm convinced you'll destroy readership by going to the type of stories you're talking about. Totally non-controversial and of very low interest to the majority of people receiving. We're going out to over 100,000, by then over 100,000 circulation, true distribution, not necessarily readership, however, but distribution. And you want to write a story about a school, we don't have much newsroom. We only have, might be going out 24 big news pages, again, broadsheet pages a week, of which more than half of that was in advertising. So we had relatively small news hole of about 12 pages or even less. If I write a story about one school and there's 200 schools in our readership area, what percentage of our readers are going to read that story about this one school? But he did not understand what I was saying, did not accept it anyway. He was convinced by his friends that we should become less controversial. So I ended up buying the Franklin County newspaper in my home state of Washington, and he brought in a new editor to do what he wanted to do, and they lost all their readership. Again, the readership and distribution are not the same thing. They still distributed over 100,000 newspapers, but people didn't read them because they weren't interesting. And so after 3 or 4 months, they realized that they had just practically committed suicide in doing this, and they changed to they did go to yellow journalism basically after that. They went way beyond what I was doing in order to try to recapture readership, and ultimately they failed, and ultimately they had to sell the newspapers. At the Franklin County newspaper, I began to realize from a publisher's perspective that the real cost of a newspaper is not the paper and ink. The real cost of a newspaper is the time that it takes to put it out. It's the staffing, the employees. Even though this was a very tiny newspaper, I knew that my time was critically important. I had to have time to sell ads. I had to have time to produce the newspaper. I'd had time to do the photography and the darkroom work. I had to have time to write the stories and do the reporting. And so if I had to spend too much time on one thing than another, I would fail. It was pretty much, it was me and a part-time receptionist, typist, and my wife was doing the bookkeeping. So I was doing almost everything. I was killing myself with all the work I was doing with this weekly newspaper. And so it forced me to realize, to start thinking about the value of time as opposed to the cost of the paper and ink. And the paper and ink was nothing compared to the value of my time. I will come back to that in a second, because I came up then with an idea that allowed me to double my revenues and and conserve my time and let me apply my time in a different way. I'll come back to that lesson. But the main lesson learned was that the cost of a newspaper is not the paper and ink. Later on, I bought a newspaper called The Entertainer. That was a free newspaper. There are now quite a few special interest, as you can tell by the name, The Entertainer is about entertainment. At least you probably assume that. There are a lot of special interest publications, and we could charge more per reader than the daily newspaper, because the only people that came that read our newspaper were those interested in entertainment. If they went to the daily newspaper, they may or may not be interested in entertainment. And so our readers were more focused. Therefore, our advertising, in fact, our advertising was probably read more than our stories. Frederick made a reference to that, and even in daily newspapers, people appreciate advertising. That's even more so if you go to a special interest newspaper, because now all the ads had to do with entertainment. So if you were looking for something to do, something interesting to do, if you're looking for entertainment, you would pick up our free newspaper. This was free, so we didn't make any money off of distribution, only off of advertising. But again, our circulation was pretty high because people knew if they were interested in entertainment, they could pick up our special interest newspaper. So that was, you know, it's not the only, there's lots of newspapers in the world and magazines in the world that prosper because of special interest focus. And it's particularly true, and in fact maybe only true, if that special interest focus includes a focus that has a lot of potential advertisers. So entertainment has a lot of potential advertisers. It's sometimes harder. For example, there have been a lot of newspapers tried to, like sports newspapers. That's harder because even though there's lots of people interested in sports, there are not a lot of companies who advertise related to sports. And so the advertising potential of a sports newspaper is not quite as great. There still are some that are successful, but it's not as clearly specialized, or the tie between specialized advertising and specialized content is not as strong, and there's not as many potential advertisers that relate to it. So you have to, you know, find the right combination, but it can be quite successful. Taking what I learned at the Franklin County newspaper, I made a proposal to take over a newspaper produced by the state of Washington. So it wasn't a commercial newspaper. In fact, there was no advertising in it whatsoever. But the person who had this contract would have to write the stories, do the production, print the newspaper, distribute the newspaper. And this was something I was very interested in doing. I am bilingual in Spanish, and this was to be a bilingual newspaper. But I'm not you know, I'm not Mexican, I'm not Hispanic by ethnicity or race. And so I was competing against somebody who was, and who had been printing the newspaper for the state for about 10 years. So I had to think really hard about, how do I get this contract? If I want this contract, how do I get it? And so I went back to what I learned at the Franklin County newspaper, and I realized that this guy was giving them 5,000 newspapers a month and distributing 5,000 newspapers a month. And he typically gave them, I think, 12 pages of content, 12 tabloid pages of content. So knowing what I knew about the cost of paper and ink, and also taking advantage of the fact that he had to have a staff, and I knew how to do newspaper all by myself, so I didn't need to have a staff. I could do it. I had one very part-time person help me with translation, but other than that, I did everything. Oh, maybe I had my, when I bundled newspapers to send, ship them out, I may have had my wife and kids help me with that. But basically, I did all the work. So knowing that I could do the work, and knowing that the paper and ink really wasn't that expensive, instead of 5,000 copies, I promised them to send out 20,000 copies. And instead of 12 pages of content, I promised them to have no fewer than 16 pages and to average 18 pages. So I'd have 16 to 20 pages of content. So I got the contract. And for 7 years, I ran this bilingual newspaper for the state of Washington. And it was, I really enjoyed it. It was very fun. But anyway, the bottom line was I knew how to approach it in a way that that the other guy, even though he had done it for 10 years, he didn't quite comprehend how I could come in and take that contract from him the way I did. Because he didn't quite understand where he was going wrong, so to speak. The Tri-City Citizen was another newspaper I started, and basically it failed. The idea of the Citizen, the way I went into it, was to make it only monthly in print, but daily online. And I might still be doing it now, except I hired some people that really were bad employees, really, really bad employees. And they really killed it. They killed me. That was my biggest problem was trusting particularly two specific individuals as employees that just, I won't even go into it, but the idea I think was still good. But the input and the expense and the problems these two employees made killed the idea. But it's I think an idea that will grow, is that, and it is growing already, that a lot of newspapers realize they're going to have to make a transition from being an all print news, or from being a print newspaper to being partial print and partial online. And I'm not saying just have an online version. For there are already some newspapers, daily newspapers, that are now printing only 3 days a week, and the other days are only online newspapers. The reason why they would do that is actually there's only 3 days a week that most newspapers make a profit. Typically, like with our newspaper, the daily newspaper I worked at, we made a good profit on Wednesday because all the grocery stores ran their ads on Wednesday. Because they wanted to run sales in the middle of the week to get people shopping. They also ran a lot of grocery store ads on Sunday, but there's lots of people who want to advertise. And Sunday's usually the biggest edition, the most read edition. People have more time to relax and read the newspaper. So Sunday is a very popular edition with lots and lots of advertising. So Sunday's profitable. And usually Friday's profitable because they're going into the weekend. And so that's kind of, they very frequently have a special section for entertainment. And so that is their entertainment related newspaper, so to speak. So those 3 days are profitable. The other days are not profitable. They lose money. And so there are some newspapers that are trying to get their, keep their readers, keep their subscribers, by offering this and lower their prices by offering this combination of 3 days a week in print every day online. But that has, I haven't heard it, that it's had any real great success, but the digital age has had a huge impact on newspapers. And so I do want to spend some time on that. So I'm going to proceed here. But I'll go back. I talked about the Franklin County. As I realized, that was my first newspaper that I actually owned myself. It was a very small newspaper, a rural newspaper, about 30 miles away from a larger city. And I was really struggling to survive. I bought this from somebody else. I had to make payments to them and continue selling ads to try to pay my own cost. And as I mentioned earlier, it was pretty much a one-man person. I had my wife very part-time and a secretary part-time. Other than that, I'd had to do everything. The writing, the reporting, writing, photography, darkroom work, advertising, sales, production. It was a very challenging but a very educational job. You learn by challenges. And I learned an awful lot during the couple of years I owned that. And one of the things I learned, as I mentioned, is that paper and ink doesn't cost very much in comparison to all the other costs of running a newspaper, including even my own salary. Paying myself enough to live on was far, far, far more expensive than the paper and ink. And so, when I first took it over, I felt like I was almost begging for people to buy ads from me. The local advertisers, the local businesses, would buy ads occasionally because they wanted the newspaper to survive, but they really didn't believe it did them much good. So it was like a charity. They were giving me advertising as a charity. That, first off, didn't make me feel good, but also meant that I didn't sell much advertising because they only bought advertising when they felt charitable, not because they felt like they needed it for their business. So I started thinking about it, and I decided to offer this. This was the package I offered them. I realized that even for their sake, they needed to take out more advertising. And I might go probably in more depth into that when we get to start talking about advertising in more depth. But when you advertise, if you don't campaign, if you don't do it like a politician would do it, you can't expect people to move to your product, to do something, to actually take action. One ad in a weekly newspaper a month is going to have almost no impact at all. That's not an advertising campaign. That is still charity. That is charity, because you're not going to get anything from it. To really get results, you need to have a consistent, you have to have a real plan on how to get this message out, and you have to have take a varied approach and do it on a regular basis. So that's something I had learned, and so that idea plus the idea that paper and ink doesn't cost very much led to this idea of helping people, having people sign a contract to advertise every week. I only asked them to pay as much as they would pay if they bought just a 1/8 page ad. That's all. But I would give them then, during the year, this would be a year-long contract, 4 full-page ads, 4 half-page ads, 4 quarter-page ads, and 40 1/8-page ads, plus 4 streamer ads and lots of classified ads. This package helped them to envision a campaign. They suddenly realized with this kind of a package, they could make a difference. So suddenly they understood. They could envision that this was no longer charity. This was something that could really work, that could really help their business. And so I signed quite a few people onto this contract and even was able to go to the city 30 miles away and sell packages like this. And so within a year, I doubled my revenue. And a year later, I sold the newspaper because I really didn't enjoy it. I enjoyed the educational experience, but there were other aspects I did not enjoy of running a small town rural newspaper. And so I took my profit and went back and got my master's degree. So this is a concept of advertising that, while I used it in my life, this is also something that other newspapers have understood, and why they would give out free circulation, why they would make other decisions, because advertising is where most of the profit comes from, and most of the revenues come from. Okay, going back to the idea of the impact on the digital age, during this, since 2005, the readership of American newspapers, these statistics all come from America, but I think the trends will ultimately impact the whole world. How soon and how, it will vary, but the trends will ultimately impact everybody. And the truth is, half of the people that used to read a newspaper no longer read a newspaper. They're going online, they're primarily online. I thought I created a new ad in here, but, well, maybe I have it still in the further. Okay, so this is showing how much readership there is in digital newspapers. So in other words, the newspapers that also have a digital format, none of these here are only online. All of these are offline and online, in other words, printed and online. And you see there are some that are quite successful. These numbers are in thousands. So USA Today, Frederick mentioned, has 34, let me see, cut this down. Okay, you have to see the legend down below. So the orange is mobile and the black is desktop access to their web pages. And so you see that overall they're getting quite a few, in fact a lot, of unique visitors every month. But then this is every month. This looks really good for them. New York Times has a lot of unique visitors every month. In the UK and United Kingdom, they have newspapers that have quite a bit of online readership. Washington Post also has a very good reputation, and therefore it has a lot of online readership. You see other newspapers drop off rather quickly. It's worth their while, obviously. It's important to them. But when you get to even smaller newspapers, it drops off dramatically. So this looks good. But even though this looked good, it really hasn't made much difference. They really have not been able to sell a lot of advertising based on their online readership. And so this is kind of disturbing. I hope the next slide is the one I was looking for. Not exactly, but another point that I found in researching this recent book was that the readers of the daily of printed newspapers are literally a dying breed. The median age, that means half of the people that read the New York Times are 60 or older. Half of them. The other half then are under 60. Well, that tells you quite a bit right there. The ones that are over 60, they're going to die, right? Some of them will, but that is truly a dying breed. That those of us that are over 60 are, we're coming towards the end of our lives. Maybe I might last another 30 years, but a lot of my classmates are already dying. Those that I went to school with when I was a kid. So if half of your readership are 60 and older, you've got a problem. And that's pretty much, I think, most newspapers are encountering that problem. So that over the next 10 to 15 years, a very large portion of their newspaper will literally die. This is some other research shows the difference in readership, or where do people get their news? Boomers refer to people my age, people born like in the after World War II, before 1960, I think. I don't know exactly what year, if there's an official time, but basically those that are born to those who fought in World War II, like my dad. So among the newspaper readers, or among the boomers like myself, 53% of us read the newspaper, printed newspaper for news. Among millennials, those, you know, younger, a lot younger, those that are, that kind of became consumers after 2000, only 22% of them read a printed newspaper anymore in America. TV is not quite so strong, but still there's a difference between boomers and millennials, even with TV. TV, I'll get into that when we start talking about TV and so forth, but TV may be, that is broadcast TV, may be a dying medium as well. Radio is holding up pretty well, but still the big difference between millennial and boomers, millennials are probably getting their music on digital-based media. Magazines, likewise, boomers versus millennials. And then you get down to things like computer. 69% of the millennials are getting theirs online. Boomers are moving that way, though, too. There's just as many people getting their news off a computer that are boomers as are getting it from newspapers now. So even they are transitioning at a much slower pace to online news than and millennials are doing it very rapidly. So like I said, 69% of them are getting off computer, only 22%, only 22% out of a printed newspaper. Tablet, not quite as dramatic a difference, but still more millennials are getting off tablets, and a very big difference on smartphones. Only 12% of boomers get their news off of smartphones, and 40% of millennials. So again, this emphasizes that those that are supporting the traditional media are truly a dying breed. The millennials and younger are going to be moving on, everything will be going mobile, online, and so forth. With that, ad sales have declined for 10 straight years for the printed newspaper in America, and they've lost now two-thirds of all their print advertising. Two-thirds of it. And this certainly does not appear to be a temporary trend. This by itself, I mentioned how important advertising is. This by itself suggests that newspapers are doomed, ultimately. Maybe USA Today will keep going. Maybe, you know, somebody will keep it going for longer, but how they can exist more than another, you know, 10 years, I would say a lot of the printed newspapers will die within 10 years. 20 years, most of them will be gone, I'm sure. That'd be my guess, but okay, here was what I was actually looking for earlier. I'm not going to try to read the whole thing, but I didn't have time to summarize it because I did this while Frederick was speaking. There's a professor, I think from Arizona, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, down here at the bottom, Chai. Anyway, she's written a book that says basically newspapers should give up trying to become digital. That is such a lost cause. They should focus on what they're doing right, which is printed, and maybe they might be able to save the printed version. I think most of us who've been publishers especially think she's crazy, but she has some argument. She's pointed out, and you can read this on your own at some point if you want to, but basically what she's finding out is that even though people go online to read some news, most of them are still going to the printed newspaper. Those that are reading the content of a newspaper are reading it in the print format. As she found, only 6% here, right here, 6% of their total readers they're only picking up 6% that are online only. The rest are really apparently preferring to get it in the printed format. So even the people that are paying a subscription, most of them are still getting reading in print and not online. In addition, not only is it a small number relatively, but in November 2012, I think these numbers are probably not this high anymore. But the average online reader spent Oh, excuse me, I was reading the wrong place. These numbers might be a little higher, actually. The amount of time people are spending on printed newspaper might have actually gone down. This might be a little bit higher, but still, it gives you an idea. As of late 2012, the average person, or the average online reader, only spent 39 minutes a month on an online newspaper, which is only 4.4 minutes a day. So that's, they're not making a big transition over to the online version, which is why she's saying you might as well quit. In fact, she's saying that basically you're spending a lot of time, a lot of money, a lot of effort trying to get people to go online, and you really, this time and effort, you'd actually make more money by emphasizing what you're doing with the printed newspaper, putting more effort into that, because you're not making piddly on what you're doing online. Well, as I said, most of us don't think she's right as far as giving up on it, because we don't see much, but she is right that you're making piddly on it. You're not making much on the online version. This is all the advertising revenue over the years. So you see how dramatically it's dropped. That's one thing you see. We already talked about that. But look what has happened to the digital. This is all the digital advertising they've been able to sell. Back in 2005, they're already selling $2 billion worth of online advertising, already in 2005. 2014, that only got up to 3.5. In fact, they got to 3.5, well, they got to 3.4 a couple of years ago. In fact, in 2008, when the recession hit, they were getting pretty close. So out of all these years, especially compared to 2008, when their overall revenues started really dropping fast, bing, 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 they've not hardly increased their online advertising sales at all. And so that actually would support Chai's argument. You're spending a lot of time for nothing. You're putting a lot of effort into nothing. But the counter argument is, what's the choice? Looking at those circulation numbers, what is the choice? We're going to be dead in 10 years if we don't figure this out. That's pretty much what they're saying. We're going to be dead in 10 years. We have to get this right, even if we're not getting it right now. And indeed, they're not. It's pitiful what they're doing so far. And the other thing that I know one expert was saying, was pointing out, and I can confirm this from being a newspaper publisher, is the problem with economy of scale. At a certain point, especially with printed newspapers, there are so many costs involved with printed newspapers, so much extra time besides just the writing. You have your print, your backroom staff that has to be doing the print work on it. You have a lot more effort in lots of areas of a printed newspaper. Certainly the circulation is part of it. An online newspaper doesn't have much circulation problem. Not much cost to an online newspaper in circulating the news. Not true with a printed newspaper. You have to get it out there. You have to pay for that paper and ink, even though it's not much. If you have high numbers, it's still very significant overall if you're losing revenue at the same time. So you're losing revenue and you're still having to print a newspaper, and you're still having to distribute the newspaper, there becomes a point where it cannot be profitable. And so, especially with printed newspapers, let's go back to the newspaper I used to work for. It was at 50,000. It's now at 40,000 circulation. So they've kept some of the local newspapers have kept their circulation up pretty high. So that suggests they could survive for a while, except they're printed, they don't have half as much advertising they used to have. They probably have maybe counting the big issues. Well, if they have half, I tell you, those days I mentioned, the days that are not profitable, those are really, really not profitable now. Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday are killing them. They should dump those papers right now. They're distributing, they have almost no advertising on those 4 days a week. If they want to survive, they should dump those and go 3 days in print and and every day online. I don't know that they're smart enough to do that, and they're afraid to do it. They're afraid of that people will give up on them even faster. But my perspective, they need to do it. Some of the bigger newspapers have gone broke. They had huge circulation. For example, the Seattle Times, I think it was. There's two newspapers in Seattle, two major newspapers. I think it's the Times that went broke a few years ago. They still had about 400,000 circulation when they went broke. They had a really good circulation, but they had already crossed the line and they could no longer, they had lost money too long, and they killed it. I think partly unions were not willing to cooperate in reducing their cost. And if they had started firing people, laying people off, they would have gone on strike or whatever. It was a mess, so they just quit. Okay, we're running out of time here, I know. Let me just go through real quick a couple of more slides here. At a certain point, there's a tipping point. Now, there was a tipping point. There's a couple of illustrations of what a tipping point might be illustrated as, a set of dominoes, where you push the first one and knock down all the other dominoes, so to speak. Or when you get to the top of a hill with pushing something heavy up the top of the hill and then it rolls down the other side. However you want to illustrate the tipping point, we reached that tipping point. If you saw back, in 2008, basically was a major tipping point where suddenly, while all businesses were hurt, newspapers started collapsing. Their advertising started collapsing and never came back again. As was mentioned, for 10 straight years now, they've lost advertising revenues. A major, major tipping point. I think this year might be the tipping point for broadcast TV. I won't go into that today, but I think it might be, again, broadcast TV may have hit its tipping point this year. So what happened when we hit that tipping point? Well, more and more advertising went to digital media. So here, the kind of silver one is Google ad revenues, black is newspaper digital ads, and then green is newspapers. And you saw what happened. 2003, they were doing great. 2004, 2005, 2006, 2007 was coming down, but still doing pretty well. And 2008 hit, started collapsing. 2009, ever since it's gone down. And look what happened at Google. Up, 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 every year going up. And what happened to newspaper digital ads and black? Not much happened. A little bit, not much. So you see, newspapers are caught in a trap here. Their digital advertising sales have not gone up. They have not figured out how to compete with the big boys online, with Google, for example. They do not know how to compete with Google and Facebook and the other big boys online. And that's where all the digital advertising is going to. In some cases, the media think they're competing with each other. And so in their mind frame, like they used to, in order to win in the newspaper business in the old days, you had to defeat your traditional media. One newspaper had to beat the other newspaper. One TV station had to beat another TV station. They're still in that mind frame, but that's not who they're competing against anymore. They think they're still competing against their local media. They're not competing against them. They're competing against Google and Facebook, and they're getting killed. They're getting killed. And so that's why I think 10 years, they're going to hit a negative tipping point in the sense of their costs are going to, their permanent costs, their costs that they cannot eliminate, will cross the point where they cannot be profitable. They do not have enough readership. They do not therefore have enough advertising to become profitable. So this trend will keep going, I think. Okay, I tried to add a couple of other slides to it, but apparently I didn't save it before I uploaded it. But anyway, that's the state of newspapers today. From the, it's not just economic, because economics involve content as well. There's big worries that the bad economics will kill investigative reporting. Newspapers have driven investigative reporting in the past. The TV has never had a big enough staff and never really quite known how to do investigative reporting like newspapers. They've never been able to afford or afford in the sense of manpower, but also afford in the sense of they don't have time. Time is money on TV. And so basically what comes on TV news is what you get on the front page of a printed newspaper. All the rest of the newspaper you don't get on TV news. And so TV or newspapers have always had the luxury of having more space and more time, more staff to do investigative reporting. TV has not. And TV is also going to hit a tipping point here. What's going to happen? Who's going to find the next Watergate? Who's going to uncover the scandals as newspapers die? That is a question that those of us in the media are asking ourselves, and we don't have a good answer to it. Some people just express the faith that there will always be somebody. There will always be people who will commit themselves to exposing the truth. And that's true. I do believe that, but not as consistently and not in the numbers that existed when newspapers prospered. Now, newspapers, I mentioned before, are quite liberal in America by our definition of liberal conservative. And I'm conservative. And so to me, I to some degree, I like fragmentation. I like more competition. I like that there's more of a conservative message on the internet. I certainly like that Fox News is now competing and offering a different version of the news in some cases than the other longer standing TV news channels and online channels. But all that said, I recognize this is a problem. If we do not have the revenues in the news business to pay for reporters to uncover the scandals, and we're dependent on people doing it even if they don't get paid anything, that's a problem. That will be a problem. And local news, probably more local investigative reporting more than in national, but national and international certainly. Okay, well, we're out of time. Thank you. I will send this PowerPoint to Professor Kim. I'll send the new syllabus to Professor Kim. Are there any questions that I can answer for you? So next week, I forget who it is that's doing the student presentation. I will probably have a little bit less.